Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Edisit Live Lecture. Dear friends, as you know that since our previous sessions, we have been talking on the socio-economic, political and cultural perspectives of the different filmmakers. We are discussing how the different filmmakers' films have contributed in the socio-economic and political as well as cultural arena. So dear friends, today we would be talking on the films of Prakash Jha, and we would be understanding what kind of and what sort of socio-economic, political and cultural perspective created by the films of Prakash Jha. And for this, we have again with us in our studios Dr. Manoj Sharma. Dr. Manoj Sharma is Assistant Professor in Department of History, Kirodimal College, University of Delhi. And dear friends, through these Edisit platform, he keeps on delivering lectures so that it becomes convenient for students to understand different topics under the subject film studies for you. So dear friends, without wasting any time, I would like to welcome our guest Dr. Manoj Sharma, and let's try to understand the perspectives on the films of Prakash Jha. So, sir, welcome to the Edisit lecture.
A very good morning to all the viewers, and today's topic of discussion is socio-economic, political and cultural perspectives in the films of Prakash Jha. Cinema, as we all know, is a medium of education, information and communication. And the most important function of cinema is considered to be the entertainment. So the films, the way the films they were being made initially, the silent films, and thereafter the talkies came, and dialogues became important in cinema. But before that, the moving images were able to create some kind of impact on the audience, those who were watching this kind of cinema. In that context, when we see certain filmmakers, those who have contributed to the socio-economic, political and cultural perspectives in the society, Prakash Jha's name is also an important concern in that context, that a number of films which he has made, they are dealing with an area, the cultural issues of an specific area. Many of his films relate to the culture of Bihar. And at the same time, he has also talked about various issues which have created some controversies in the media as well as in the society. So these kind of issues which he has taken up, they are trying to create some kind of consciousness among the masses so that the people, they can dwell upon these issues and they come up with certain ideas so as to rectify the kind of problems which are afflicting the society. In that context, the socio-economic challenges of the society which are there, the filmmaker has tried to tackle all these kind of socio-economic challenges in the context of the films which he has made. And at the same time, the nexus of the politicians and the criminals, and it has also been discussed in the political arena, and a number of directives have been issued by the people, those who have been associated with the election commission, that more and more criminalization of the politics is taking place and criminals, they are contesting elections. So this kind of a nexus, and so as to root out a number of measures, they have also been suggested. So in this context, when we see these kind of films, we are able to relate with the contemporary reality, in the sense that measures they have been taken at the level of the government, at the level of the election commission, that the criminals, they are not able to enter the politics. And at the same time, the level of the politicians in that context, in the terms of literacy, how educated they are, some of the reforms which have been undertaken in this context, they also relate to education as well, in terms of declaring that how the people, those who are contesting elections, they have to declare about their educational qualifications. And a number of cases, they have also created some kind of controversy when people, they have submitted fake certificates in the political arena. And these issues, they have also been taken up in some of the films as well. So what we see in the context of the films which have been made by Prakash Jha, we see that the kind of political dimensions which are there, they have been taken up. and how corruption was an important issue in many of the films which have been made by Prakash Jha. The portrayal of the police forces, many a times police forces, they have been shown in collaboration with the politicians as well as the criminals. And at the same time, in many of the films which have been made by Prakash Jha, you will also find that the police officer who is a protagonist is a very upright and honest officer, and who is working as some sort of a vigilante, in the sense that he is tackling the problems himself. He is taking upon the law unto himself, and is sensitive in that context, that he realizes that the poor people, those who are at the receiving end of the law, they should be provided the kind of justice which they deserve and which is not being provided to them. So these kind of issues, they have been taken up in the films of Prakash Jha. And at the same time, the bureaucratic red tape, which is evident in the society, that how bureaucracy, the role of bureaucracy in the context, that many of the projects, how they have been delayed, how corruption scandals are there with regard to the bureaucracy, and how bureaucracy is hand in glove with the politicians, and both the bureaucracy and the politicians, and in the context how they collaborate with the criminals as well. And this creates some kind of a vitiated atmosphere for the common people, and common people are not able to secure any kind of justice within the constraints which have been imposed by the people, those who are the real power wielders in this context. And at the same time, in many of the films of Prakash Jha, we will also talk about the women's issues, in the context that the way women, they have been portrayed, the kind of issues of women which have been taken up, they have been portrayed in a very powerful or a potent way, and how they are not mere appendages to the men in terms of decision making, their own decision makers. So these kind of portrayals, which are more contemporary in nature and which are dealing with the socio-economic, political as well as the cultural aspects of a particular region, and at the same time they are also reflecting the Indian reality, in the sense that in many other states similar kinds of things and activities are taking place. So they have been dealt in the films of Prakash Jha. And at the same time, the kind of issues, that how these kind of issues, they have to be dealt by the people, those who are concerned, be the protagonist or the people, those who are associated with the protagonist. The ways and means which they find so as to tackle these kind of problems in the society. And at the same time, how cinema is seen by the public now. We say that how to read a film. So reading a book and reading a film are two different things, because when we are watching a film, generally we don't say we are reading a film. So in that context, reading films so as to make meanings out of those films have become quite important in recent times. And the impact of cinema on the masses has also been very, very important in this context, that cinema is a new audiovisual source. We are saying new in this context, that cinema began its journey only in 1895, and we have other sources of documenting history earlier. So in that context, when we see that it is a new audiovisual source, and how the portrayal of reality and the cultural motifs is taking place in cinema, and the kind of impact it is creating, and how cinema is being used by the leaders for propaganda in the elections, and how it promotes culture, fashion and identity. So what we see is that cinema has various kind of dimensions, and it also is reflecting the kind of reality which is there in the society, and the cultural motifs or the symbols, they are also understood within a specific context. The kind of motifs or symbols which are shown in the films, the audience are able to relate with it because they are part of their society, and they have a meaning within a particular context. And at the same time, use of cinema or the kind of audiovisual media has become quite important in the recent times. The use of cinema was there during the elections in 1936-37 as well, when one of the Congress leaders, Satyamurthy, used cinema for propaganda purposes during the times of elections. And similarly, nowadays what we see is that the all kinds of audiovisual medium is being used by the politicians so as to put across their messages to the common audience or the people, those who are the electorate. So in this way, the reach of the cinema through the new technological mediums, by the way of the internet, by the way of various social networking sites, they have created new platforms by which we can disseminate information and at the same time also give the kind of opinions, our opinions, which may be useful for some others, or they may also create some kind of impact on the society. At the same time, it is promoting cultures. Cultures, as we know, that cinema is trying to recreate the kind of reality which it wants to portray. And even if cinema is more commercial in nature, it is more fantasy oriented, even then the kind of the portrayal it wants to project, it is affecting the masses, because the masses, they have all those kind of desires. Many of them, they have these kind of desires to have that kind of lifestyle or that kind of fantasy lifestyle which is being portrayed in the films. And at the same time, a lot of fashion is being shown in the films, and how the film shows the fashions, it is being in a way imbibed by the people, those who watch these kind of audiovisual images. The question of identity in the recent times has garnered a lot of importance in the context that many times we fight over our identity. So the question of identity is very important in this context, that all of us, we have multiple identities. We have our identities on the basis of our caste, we have our identities on the basis of our region, we have identities on the basis of our language, so that linguistic identity, and the identity on the basis of nation. So within the constraints or within the kind of multiple identities which we have, we try to portray ourselves and we try to lead our lives in that context. And at the same time, these kind of identities, they create a lot of polarization within the society. And this kind of polarization is, in a way, it affects the kind of unity which is there in the society. And when we talk about the society, films and society, they have very close kind of a connection, because the message of the film is not contained only in the dialogues of the films, but the symbols, they play an important part in these films. And what we see is that symbols are part and parcel of a certain social and historical context, and they generate emotions and they excite large number of masses at the same time. They also help in creating appropriate emotional response among the audience. So what we see is that when we are talking about film and society, generally we see that there is a lot of debate, that the people, those who say that cinema is a mirror reflection of society, whatever is being shown in the cinema is existing in the society. And on the other hand, there are people, the scholars, those who criticize this viewpoint, they say that cinema is showing the make-believe things. Cinema is not the reflection of society. Many of the things which are part of the society, they are not being reflected in the cinema in a proper way. Rather, cinema is sometimes exaggerating the reality, or many a times it is undermining the or making some sort of an understatement on the reality. So both the viewpoints which exist, there is a lot of debate in this context. But at the same time, the people, the average cinegoers, or the people, those who are going and watching these films, they have definitely, we will say that cinema is creating an impact on them, as we see that how fashion trends, how the culture of a particular region, it is being affected by the films. How Hindi film songs, though Hindi is not understood in South India, but they are quite popular in South India as well. The dance and song sequences, which are part of the Hindi cinema, which was criticized a lot earlier by many of the film critics, and they wanted that these kind of dance and song sequences should not be there in the Hindi films, as Hindi films were to be seen in comparison to the Hollywood cinema, which was devoid of these dance and song sequences. So, but the people, those who are talking about the cultural aspects, they will definitely say that these dance and song sequences are definitely part of Indian culture, and we have songs and dances for each and every occasions, be it for marriages, be it for death, be it for any other religious and social activity. We have songs for all these kinds of ceremonies, and at the same time dances, the various kind of dances which are quite popular across India in different parts, they are also part of our society. So in this context, when we are talking about a cinema which is trying to portray reality, dance and song sequences are also part of that particular reality, and they are trying to reflect the kind of traditions, the kind of customs which are prevalent in the society. When we are talking about Prakash Jha, we will say that Prakash Jha was born in 1952, and the kind of films which he has made, they are known for political and socio-political films which he has made. And when we will talk about the films which he has made, we will try to analyze and understand the kind of films he has made in a socio-political milieu, the kind of films which were made at a particular point of time, and how the society received those films. Many of the films were not very successful, but at the same time they raised certain issues in the context of the societal matters. So his films are closer to reality in that context, and they try to reflect the socio-political and cultural situation in minute details. Many of his films are based in Bihar, and they show the culture of that particular region. What is unique about Prakash Jha is that he has used mainstream film actors in issue-based films. Many of the films which have been made by Prakash Jha, they are issue-based in nature, and some of the films they also created some kind of controversies as well. But at the same time, his films, they were issue based in nature, and at the same time he was not using completely non-professional actors, rather he was using the mainstream or the commercial film stars in his films, as you see that Amitabh Bachchan, Kareena Kapoor, Katrina Kaif, all these Deepika Padukone, Saif Ali Khan, Ajay Devgan, they have been used time and again. And all these film stars or film actors, they are largely doing the commercial films. So what kind of, the kind of stereotyping which happens when one is doing commercial films, Prakash Jha is trying to portray the characters in that context, that he is trying to deconstruct or destroy the image of the film star. And these kind of film actors, they are seen as the characters in the film, they are not seen as film stars when they are working in such kind of cinema. So using those film stars in such a way that they become the characters when they are doing this kind of film is a great contribution when we see some of the films which have been made by him. Hip Hip Hooray was the first film which was directed by Prakash Jha, and in this, when you see the story, there was a computer engineer played by Raj Kiran, and he is looking for a job. He wants to take up his first job and takes a temporary job as a sports instructor in a school at Ranchi, and there he meets an apathetic school principal, and he also develops some kind of relationship with the teacher, and eventually he leads football team to victory. So this kind of story in which he makes his debut is about a youth who is unemployed, and he has to take a temporary job so that he can support the family, and the kind of problems he has to engage with, because the people, those who are at the power center, the people, those who are wielding authority in the school, they are not the people, those who are ready to take the responsibility. And he is able to take some responsibility in the context that he is ready to shape the football team of the school. And finally, with all the kinds of hurdles which he faces in his new job, he is able to secure victory. Another important film in 1984 itself, which was made by Prakash Jha, was Damul. Damul means the bonded labor. And this film was critically acclaimed. It was dealing with a very specific issue, which was quite relevant to the Indian society, the issue of bonded labor and how people, they were being exploited at different levels by people, those who were in authority and power, and how the caste politics which was there and the subjugation of the lower caste was being done through the bonded labor. This was also being discussed in the film. And at the same time, the film was also focusing on the migration of the underprivileged villagers of Bihar to the affluent states like Punjab to explore options of livelihood. So what we see in Damul largely is that the caste politics is being highlighted. The people, those who belong to the lower caste, how they are being exploited by the people, those who belong to the upper caste. And at the same time, why? Because of the scarcity of opportunities in a state like Bihar, people, they had to migrate to other areas in search of employment. And this has also been discussed in the elections as well, that Bihar did not have all those kind of employment opportunities, and during the tenure of the recent governments, how employment opportunities were created so that migration does not take place. But to what extent these kind of migrations, they were being stopped, and the way things could be handled in a different matter. But this issue was quite relevant in 1980s and 90s in the context that many people, they were migrating from Bihar to other regions so that they can take up employment. And Punjab and Haryana provided opportunities in the sense that the Green Revolution had taken place in 1968-69, and thereafter these regions had become quite prosperous, and the zamindars or the big peasants of these regions, they required labor, and the labor was being provided by these people, those who had become migrants. So the issue of the lopsided development of the regions in the context that some of the regions where the agricultural revolution took place in the context of the Green Revolution, they became quite prosperous, and the other regions, they could not develop. So this kind of lopsidedness in the context of the development of regions, and at the same time the exploitation of the people, those who migrated from one area to another, were some of the issues which have been dealt in this particular film. And at the same time, we'll also talk about the kind of exploitation of the people which takes place at the hands of the employers. The people, those who are migrating, they did not have economic resources, and at the same time they were at the mercy of the people, those who were providing them employment. And when they were at the mercy, they did not have this kind of voice where they can raise their concerns with regard to the kind of time limits to which they have to work. And at the same time, they were not in a bargaining capacity, that where they could bargain for the kind of money which they require. So the way they were being underpaid, the way they were being overworked, these were the issues which have been discussed in some of the films of Prakash Jha and other filmmakers as well. But Damul specifically deals with a particular issue. And this film was awarded in 1984-85. The National Film Award for the Best Feature Film was given to this, and it was able to receive the Critics Award as well. Another film which I would like to talk about was a film called Mrityudand, which he made in 1997. So, as you can see on the screen as well, that Mrityudand starred Madhuri Dixit, Shamana Azmi and Om Puri. And this film, which means death sentence, was tackling women's status in society. It was some sort of a commentary on social and gender injustice. It was straddling the boundary between the art film and the commercial film. And the film starts with a ghastly portrayal of a mob killing off two defenseless women. So what we see is that how women, they are being treated in a patriarchal society. Quite often in the newspapers, we read about so many issues which are relating to the abuse of women in the domestic sphere as well as in the sphere of the society. We quite often read in the newspapers about the kind of acid attacks on the women, that how the jilted lovers, they got vengeful towards these women and they threw acids on them. We also hear so many stories that how they are being manhandled when they are working as maids and servants in the various homes. Quite often we hear that how young girls, those who are minors, they are being in a way maltreated in the various homes in which they are being kept as maids. So all these kind of issues where women, they are not being provided employment, the women, they are not being provided any kind of education, how they are being mistreated at the home and at the level of society. All these have been discussed in the films which have been made by him. And at the same time, this kind of gender injustice which is being provided to the women has been raised by Prakash Jha in his film. And at the same time, when we watch the films which have been made by him, so there is a very thin distinction between the art film and the commercial film. It is not a totally commercial popular masala film. Rather, the kind of aesthetics which is being depicted in his film, so it can be said that his film is both an art film as well as a commercial film. His films are being made with the popular film stars, those who are commercially successful. But at the same time, the kind of issues which have been raised, a lot of audience also goes to watch these kind of films. Because if we make films which are not being watched by the audience, and if they are only made for a specific target audience, so it defeats its own purpose, because the purpose of a particular cinema maybe should be so that more and more people they watch such kind of issue-based cinema. And what we see in this particular film is that the film starts with the way a mob attacks two defenseless women. So initially, the way the film will unfold is definitely shown, and how this is being done by the vested interest which are there, that has also been shown. And how any kind of administrative inquiry in this incident should be evaded, and how people, those who are in a way responsible for this, the people, those who want to take any kind of advantage with this, they do not want that these kind of issues, they should be highlighted in the media. People should not come to know about these kind of issues, so that they are able to maintain their hegemony, or they are able to maintain their influence within the society. And what we also see that how the main role, the main lead role played by Madhuri Dixit in the film, and the role of the husband played by Ayub Khan, he also got influenced by such kind of elements which are there in the film, that he also becomes more and more dominant towards his own wife. So in this way, the kind of torture, the kind of mental trauma which has been undergone by the female protagonist is being portrayed, and the kind of influence, or the negative influence which her husband acquires in the film, has also been shown. And this leads to the kind of alcoholism, the kind of domestic abuse, and the selfishness and the self-centeredness of the male protagonist, which has also been shown. And how the female protagonist, she is trying in this way to fight her case, that how she is making best efforts to fight this particular issue, and how the forces of oppression and the male domination in the village, they are more dominant. And on the other hand, the women, especially shown in the context of Madhuri Dixit, they are trying to in a way tackle these kind of issues in a manner. So these kind of issues, they became quite relevant during this particular period as well, because the issues of women's emancipation, they were there since the social religious reform movements in the 19th century and thereafter. And when the Constitution of India gave the right to freedom to everybody and right to equality to every individual who is a major, who is a resident or a citizen of citizen of India. So this kind of equality and freedom is being guaranteed to every individual, and when this kind of freedom and equality is being denied to any individual on the basis of gender, on the basis of sex, it is also against the constitution. But this kind of practices which are patriarchal in nature, they do not want that such kind of gender justice should be done. Another film which I would like to talk about is Gangajal, in which Ajay Devgan, Gracie Singh and Mukesh Tiwari, they played the central parts, as you can see on the screen as well. The film also talked about the blinding incidents which took place at Bhagalpur. They also deal with the political and bureaucratic corruption. The story relates, the background is Bihar, in which police was under the control of a local don played by Sadhu Mohan Joshi as Sadhu Yadav, and his son Sundar Yadav played by Yashpal Sharma, and in which you have Mukesh Tiwari playing the role of Bachcha Yadav, and he was instrumental in pouring the acid in the eyes of the people, those who have been arrested, and it was referred to as Gangajal in the film. So what we see is that the film also talks about the kind of nexus of the politicians and the criminals, as well as how bureaucrats, they also get involved in this kind of sharing of power or authority, and how the local people and how the people, those who are the common masses, they have to suffer in this context. So Gangajal makes a statement in which Ajay Devgan has played the role of the protagonist, an IPS officer, and how he is trying to bring some kind of order in the kind of district which he has been allotted by the government. And because the law and order situation is pathetic, and law is generally controlled by the local dons or the mafias, and how these people, those who are on the other side of the law, they have all the kinds of advantages. They are living a life of affluence, and they have all the disregard for any kind of authority when they are having all kinds of the kind of actions which have been undertaken by them. So this kind of a situation where police as a law enforcing authority is not very relevant, where politicians they dominate the affairs of that particular state, in the context that how they have that kind of a nexus with the criminals, and criminals and politicians along with their bureaucracy create such kind of problems for the common masses that even the honest and idealist police officers, they have to step in. So this was one of the films which became quite successful at the box office, and at the same time this film was critically appreciated as well. And what another important film which I would like to talk about is Aparan or Kidnapping, which was made in 2005, and the film stars Ajay Devgan and Nana Patekar. So in this film what we see is that there is a complex relationship between the father and the son, in the sense that they have different ideologies, and this is set against or set in the backdrop of the kidnapping industry in Bihar. So what we see is that Ajay Devgan, who plays the role of Ajay Shastri, is an unemployed honest graduate in the film, and he also dreams of joining the police force, but he did not have money because the kind of corruption, the kind of corruption which was prevalent in the state required the people, those who were joining any kind of services, they had to pay bribes so as to get appointed in the various services. And the role of father, played by Mohan Agashe, who is a highly principled and a moralistic man, and this fellow is an ex-school teacher and a Gandhian, and he has now become a social activist. So what we see is that there is a clash of ideologies, in the sense that father is a Gandhian and he is also a moralistic and a principled man, and he will not want his son to get any kind of appointment in a job by paying bribes. So he is not in favor of such kind of appointments, and son is looking for some kind of money so that he can pay that kind of money and get a job. And finally he takes some kind of a loan so that he can get that money, and his name also comes in the list of the people, those who have been selected. But his father is at the forefront of this kind of agitation, where all this kind of bungling, all this kind of cheating is going on, and he discloses or is instrumental in disclosing of this kind of a story, and the results are being cancelled. And now the son is without a job, because he will not get that kind of job where this kind of wrongdoing has already taken place. And these kind of similarities you will find in various state commission exams, a number of inquiries which are being conducted by CBI and other police departments with regard to these kind of problems in the Indian society. So the issue is very contemporary in nature, and it is set in the kidnapping industry of Bihar. At one point of time, these kind of issues with regard to law and order situation, with regard to the kidnappings in a particular area, they became quite a fodder for the headlines which were coming time and again in the newspapers. So these kind of issues, they became quite relevant. And how Prakash Jha tackles these issues, how he shows these issues in a very creative manner so that people, they become aware about these kind of issues. And when Ajay Devgan is left with no option, he also decides to join the kidnapping industry so as to pay back the money which he had loaned. And in this, he comes into conflict with the people, those who are the established players in this field, those who have become professionals in that sense in this particular industry, and how their interests, they clash, and the kind of problems which are being encountered by Ajay Devgan in the film. So the issue of unemployment, the way it has been handled, how it has been handled in the backdrop of the kidnapping industry, has been quite satisfactorily dealt in the film. Though film was not a major success, but at the same time it was dealing with an issue which was quite contemporary in nature. Now I would like to talk about a film called Rajneeti, which was made in 2010, and Rajneeti draws some kind of parallels. As you can see on the screen as well, that it is talking about an epic called Mahabharat, and how the various characters, they have different kinds of shades. For example, Nana Patekar had shades of Krishna, Ranbir Kapoor had shades of Arjun Rampal had shades of Bhim, and Manoj Vajpayee had shades of Duryodhan, and Ajay Devgan had shades of Karna. So all these kind of characters which have been portrayed, they had different shades of the mythological epic Mahabharat. And at the same time, how it was dealing with the issue of political corruption. And it also created some kind of controversies, as many of the characters, they were seen as similar to some real life people and characters in the film. So Rajneeti, this film is very important in the context that it directly means politics, and the characters, those who have played a part in this film, they are dealing with this kind of issue called Rajneeti. And when they are dealing with these kind of issues, the film story has a lot of twists and turns, and these kind of twists and turns, they are played in the context of a political party, and how people from a political family, they are fighting against each other so as to get more power and authority. And in this case, they are leaving no stone unturned. In that sense, they are doing all kinds of efforts, whether they are fair or unfair, so as to achieve their aims and objectives. So what we see during this particular period is that these kind of issues which are there in the contemporary reality, they have been shown in such films called Rajniti. One of the statements which Ranbir Kapoor makes in the film is that politics is a game that brings out inner evil. So when he says that politics is a game which talks about or which will bring out the inner evil, so definitely he is making a statement that people will leave their morals in that context and they will be ready to go to any kind of extent to achieve their objectives. This is what he means when he makes this kind of a statement. Nikhat Kazmi was a film critic who was associated with Times of India, and she remarked, the film basically anchors its plot in two classic tales, the Mahabharata and the Godfather, to create an engrossing diatribe on India's political system where democracy may prevail but not in its purest form. So what we see is that a statement which is talking about the kind of inspirations of this film, Mahabharata and the Godfather, and we will talk about the democracy, but the democracy may not function the way it has been designed. So these are the kind of issues which have been talked about in this particular film. Another film which I like to talk about is Arakshan, which was made in 2011. Arakshan was a film which was dealing with the issue of reservations, and it was also a film which was shown in the context of coaching classes, that how the capitalist coaching classes, they become important. The film starred Amitabh Bachchan, Saif Ali Khan and Deepika Padukone. Film deals with the policy of caste-based reservations in Indian government jobs and educational institutions. And it also talks about the travails of the India's education system. It exposes the politico-capitalist nexus and it attacks the capitalist coaching institutions. So what we see in this film is that the policy of caste-based reservation is being talked about, and it created a lot of controversy as well with regard to this policy, and at the same time how the India's education system, the kind of problems which India's education system has, they were also being talked about in this particular film. The film also exposed the the politico-capitalist nexus, that how the capitalists, they are in nexus with the politicians, and in a way how they want to control the kind of education system which is there, not only in terms of its ideological orientations, so as they are able to mentor or they are able to shape the ideological orientation of the various educational institutions. But at the same time, their main function is to see that they are able to garner a lot of revenue, a lot of money. And in this context, what we see is that the role played by Manoj Vajpayee is in context that he was in a promotion for the coaching institutes where huge sums of money they are being paid, and students, if they have to get selected to coveted examinations, then they have to pay huge money so that they can attend the coaching classes. And the contrast was in the form of a coaching center which was opened by Amitabh Bachchan in the film, which was opened in a tabela or a cowherd, and how these coaching institutions become some sort of a competition for the other coaching centers. So this idea of a tabela or a cowherd was inspired by a group called Super 30, which was started by Anand Kumar in Bihar. So this was an experiment which was initiated by him long back, and how he was providing coaching to some of the needy students, those who did not have any kind of resources, and only 30 students they were being selected to be coached. And how these people, many a times, all 30 of them, they cracked the IIT exams. So Indian Institute of Technology exams, which is the most premier institution for engineering in India, and which is a very difficult kind of exam, these are being cracked by the people, those who did not have access to the classroom coaching which was being provided by high tech coaching institutions. Rather, they were being trained in their coaching by someone who was doing it at his own expense and at not the kind of scale. So this was one of the achievements of the kind of systems which was there, and it was being shown in the film as well. And what we see is that Arakshan, you find that a number of bans they were being imposed on this particular film in different states of India. For example, in Punjab, a ban was imposed that certain scenes and dialogues of this film may inflame passion of some communities in Punjab. So that is why some kind of a ban was clamped. Then on UP, on grounds that it could create law and order problem in the state. In Andhra Pradesh, also it was being banned. CBFC granted film a UA certificate, saying that it would defend Prakash Jha's right to free expression. So what we see is that film was given UA certificate, and the right of Prakash Jha for the freedom of expression was being given by CBFC in the form of a certificate which was being given to the film. Another film which I would like to talk about is Chakravyuh. Chakravyuh was made in 2012, and Chakravyuh was a social commentary on the issues of the Naxalites and their problems. You had Arjun Rampal, Manoj Vajpayee and Abhay Deol in the film, and the plot is inspired by Namak Haram, a film made in 1973 by Hrishikesh Mukherjee. So what we see is that Chakravyuh was talking about the question of resources in the given society, that the issue of Naxalites, that why people, they became Naxalites, and how the resources which were due to them, they were not being given to them. And in the film, what we see is that the role which has been played by Arjun Rampal, he has been appointed as a police officer in a district, and he realizes that it will be very difficult for him to control that area, because that area has been influenced by the Naxalite activities. And one of his older friends, played by Abhay Deol, he talks to him and suggests that he will enter as a friend of the Naxalites, and thereafter he will come to know about the kind of activities of these people and provide a lot of information about their whereabouts. And this is what exactly happens. And when this happens in the film, what we see is that Abhay Deol, while providing information, he also gets influenced by the kind of ideology, kind of poverty, the kind of starvation which is being experienced by the people, those who have been pushed to the margins. So he realizes that these are the people, those who have been wronged, these are the people, those who have been not given the kind of resources which they deserve, and they have taken up arms because they have no option left. So similarly, there is a kind of resonance in the theme when you compare it with the film called Namak Haram, in which Amitabh Bachchan and Rajesh Khanna, both of them, they acted, and Rajesh Khanna enters the workers union as some sort of a person who will help Amitabh Bachchan, who is an industrialist, and later he develops some kind of a bond with the workers, and this kind of a situation creates a rift between friends. So here also, when a friend enters the areas of the Naxalites, he becomes an important functionary of their group, and at the same time he develops all kinds of sympathies to these people, is also shown in this particular film. And what also we see is that the film created some kind of a controversy with regard to a controversial song which was shown in the film, and this film and Bata India dragged Prakash Jha to the court for this song. Song was Bata considered it to be harmful, malicious and defamatory. Birla ho ya Tata, Ambani ho ya Bata, sabne apne chakkar mein desh ko hai kaata, अरे हमरे ही खून से इनका इंजन चले ठकाठक. एंड दिस वॉज सजेस्टिंग दैट द लार्ज बिजनेस हाउसेज इन इंडिया आर एक्सप्लॉयटिंग द पुअर फॉर प्रॉफिट्स. सो वॉट दिस फिल्म वॉज टॉकिंग अबाउट वॉज इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ महंगाई और द काइंड ऑफ इन्फ्लेशन वी क्वाइट ऑफन टॉक अबाउट दैट द प्राइसेज ऑफ पल्सेज आर rising, prices of onions are rising, the wholesale price index, the consumer price index. So all these kind of issues which are quite relevant to the Indian kitchen and Indian household, that quite often people talk about the kind of inflation which is taking place in the society. And the film was, the way the song was picturized, it created a controversy, and Prakash Jha was taken to the court for this, though he was let off by the court, and it was suggested that one should be careful in terms of causing any kind of offense to the people if their names are there in such kind of portrayals. So what we see is that his films are dealing with all these kind of contemporary issues which are quite relevant to the Indian society. Another film which I'd like to talk about is Satyagraha, and Satyagraha means fighting for the truth and fighting against the corruption. And in this film also, Amitabh Bachchan plays the role of a protagonist, and he is shown to be some sort of a modern day Gandhi. He is very idealistic and he wants to give something to the society. On the other hand, the role played by Ajay Devgan, he is a representative of New India and shown as a brilliant communication czar, and he wants to use the ways of the world to get what he wants. So the kind of portrayals which are taking place in this particular film, how Amitabh Bachchan, how Ajay Devgan, how Kareena Kapoor is being portrayed. Kareena Kapoor is being portrayed as an independent journalist, and how she has her own opinions, and she is guided by her own opinions, and she is not and she is ready to part way with her love interest played by Ajay Devgan in the film if they are not on the same par in terms of their principles and ideology. And in the film, both of them, they later reunite as well, whereas when they come to come to the par in that sense that they agree on their own their principles that so these kind of portrayals were in a way were trying to portray women in this context that they have their own opinions and they can take their own decisions in that context. And the film was also raising certain issues that how the kind of idealism which was missing in the society, the kind of righteousness which was missing in the society should be brought back to the society in some way or the other. He also made a film called Lok Nayak, which was financed by the Ministry of Culture on Lok Nayak Jai Prakash Narayan. It was some sort of a biographical which was made by him. And when you talk about some other films which were made by other filmmakers on the similar theme, one was film Nayak, which was directed by S. Shankar. So the film was not by Prakash Jha, but similar themes, some of the films I would like to talk about is Nayak, in which Anil Kapoor plays the role of a TV journalist, and how he is made as a CM, the CM for a day. And when he is accusing the current chief minister that he is not able to control the violence in the state and he was not working for the growth and development of the state. So when this kind of accusation is being made by Anil Kapoor in the film to the chief minister, he says that you be the chief minister for a day. And when he becomes the chief minister for a day, the kind of changes which he brings, the kind of corruption cases which were which take place during this particular period, that he is ready to show the door to the people, those who are engaging in corrupt practices. So this has been shown in this particular film, and some kind of parallels in the popular culture they have also been drawn, because when you talk about the kind of political rise of Arvind Kejriwal and how he is also seen as some sort of a crusader. So some kind of parallels in the popular culture by certain people, they have been drawn in the context of the victory of a party and that party was some sort of a very fresh party which did not have any kind of base at the political in the context of the political level, and how this party rose to the prominence because of a crusade of one person. And so this has been drawn some kind of parallels in that context. And some other films which I'd like to point out of other directors, like one of the film by Rajkumar Santoshi with the title of Halla Bol, and this film was tackling various issues like Jessica Lal murder case, Amir Khan's involvement with Narmada Bachao Andolan, Right to Information Act, public participation in fighting corruption, and civil society movements. So all these issues, they have been talked about in this particular film. Even the issue of civil society movements, in which nowadays what we see is that many groups, they are doing some kind of candlelight kind of walks so as to protest. And similarly, various events which have taken place in the society, they are being portrayed in a way that they are able to convey some kind of meaning. And at the same time, when you see that this particular film was also talking about the murder of a person who was associated with theater, and how that person who was murdered by the political rivals, that has also been portrayed in this particular film. Halla Bol means to raise a voice, and Rajkumar Santoshi in this film talks about the protagonist played by Ajay Devgan, that how he has to raise his voice because he is a person who has risen from the ranks of the theater and he has become a popular film star. And the kind of changes which come in this popular film star, because now he has to maintain his identity, he has to create some kind of a persona for the public. And when he has to create some kind of a persona for the public, he was losing his own individual identity and the kind of ideals and the kind of righteousness with which he was associated earlier, it takes a back seat. So all these kind of issues, they have been taken up in some of the films which have been made. Khaki was another film which was made with the same kind of issue of the nexus of the politicians and the criminals, and how a police party becomes some sort of a how it became some sort of a problem in this context, that it came into a problem because of this kind of a nexus. This film was also made by Rajkumar Santoshi. So some other films which I have discussed, they have some kind of resonances, or similarities with the kind of themes which have been made, which have been shown in the films of Prakash Jha. When in the context of retrospect, when I would like to talk about that the films of Prakash Jha, they were dealing with some of the real issues in the society. How these issues they were being shown on cinema was a matter of concern for some people, those who accused him of showing some kind of a controversial issues. At the same time, the women's issues and challenges, they were also being shown in his films. And various films which we have talked about, they were dealing with varied themes. But all these kind of themes, they were relating to the society in the context that they were trying to depict the criminals, political, as well as the bureaucratic nexus, and how this nexus was creating some kind of an impediment to the law and order situation, and how the local masses or the common masses, they should be given the kind of justice which they deserve by these law enforcement agencies. So I'd like to end the discussion by saying that definitely Prakash Jha's films are quite contemporary in nature, and definitely they have made some kind of statement to the masses. Thank you so much.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. And dear friends, we would be meeting again in another few sessions where we would be discussing more on the social, cultural and political perspectives by the different filmmakers, the films of different filmmakers, and what impact they have raised and what impact they have produced. So we would be meeting again, as I already said, and you can access this lecture with the help of YouTube if you wish to do so, and afterwards you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.